So thank you everyone for coming. My name is Sarah Hickox and I've had the pleasure of introducing the fish lecture for more than 25 years, which is a pretty exciting tenure for a program like this. As a bit of background, the fish lecture is named in honor of the founders of the Graduate School of Oceanography, Bobby and Charlie Fish. They really found the original Narragansett Marine Lab that eventually then became the Graduate School of Oceanography. So in 89, the Fish family, their names were Monroe, actually were the ones who created the endowment that funds this lecture, and Joe Monroe is here today with his wife Jean, and none of them became scientists, even though his in-laws, Bobby and Charlie Fish, were scientists, obviously. But now, two generations later, their great-granddaughter, Bailey Monroe, Bailey, you can wave here, is a scientist, and she just three weeks ago, defended her PhD in neuroscience at URI. So she now is... She's now another Dr. Fish Monroe. So, and her boyfriend Dan Sheldon is here and some of their neighbors, so we're happy that you could come. So today we celebrate more than a quarter century of these lectures, and I'd like to introduce Associate Dean David Smith, who will welcome you on behalf of GSO.
Thanks, sir. Okay, thanks. On behalf of our Dean, Bruce Corless, who can't be here today, it's my pleasure to welcome you here to the Bay Campus, University of Rhode Island's Graduate School of Oceanography. We're really proud of our program here, and all of our talks are open to the public. This is one program where we really try to bring in people from outside of GSO to give them a glimpse of what we're doing in here. And so today we are lucky to have one of the world-renowned experts on hurricane science, and so we thought what better way to introduce him than to have our own world-renowned expert in hurricane science, Professor Isaac Guinness.
Well, thank you, David, for the introduction. I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Chris Landsea, who is a science and operations officer at the National Hurricane Center. Dr. Landsea received his bachelor's degree in computers in atmospheric science from University of California, Los Angeles, in 1987, his master's degree and doctoral degree in atmospheric science from the Colorado State University in 1991 and 1994. His thesis advisor was Dr. Bill Gray, a renowned hurricane expert. Dr. Landsea's main scientific expertise in a seasonal hurricane forecasting and hurricane climate variability and natural and climate variability. In addition to his forecasting and training duties as science and operation officers at NHC, he currently serves as the director of the NOAA's Joint Hurricane Testbed. And this program, NOAA's program, supports the transition of the research to operations. And in that role, Dr. Landsea has overseen several of our projects of our research group, aiming to transition our research to improve the NHC operational hurricane prediction models. Dr. Landsea is a recipient of numerous awards. In 2011, he was recipient of a Department of Commerce Gold Medal for excellence in research leading to a more confident assessment of the influence of human-induced climate change on hurricanes. And finally, I would like to recognize his contribution to our educational website here at GSO, Hurricane Science and Society, which has become one of the important educational tools for science educators nationwide and plays an important role in educating the students and adults on hurricane science and hurricane impacts. So Dr. Landsea has served as a science advisor on our website and also contributed to the content. So, please help me to welcome Dr. Landsea, who is visiting GSO for the first time.
All right, well, good afternoon, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. It is my first visit to the university, and it's a neat opportunity, and I'm not going to see this kind of cold weather again in Miami until November, so I enjoy it. This is nice. Now, you may have seen the title slide here, and my name is Chris Landsea. I'm the science officer at the Hurricane Center, and you may be thinking there is no way that his real name is Landsea, okay, given that I work on hurricanes. And indeed, my wife and I, when we are having our first child born, I thought I had the perfect name for either a boy or a girl. So if it was a girl, it could be E-R-I-N, or if the bad joke didn't happen yet. Or if it was a boy, it would be A-A-R-O-N. That would be Air and Landsea. So my wife vetoed that. Instead, we did name our kids after retired hurricanes. So that is true. So what I'm going to walk you through is what we do at the National Hurricane Center to keep the public safe. And what we do is we're forecasters. And to paraphrase our mission statement there, we analyze and predict hurricanes and marine weather so that people don't get hurt and that people can safeguard their properties. And so that's why we exist. We have 60 people at the National Hurricane Center. So we're about the same size as, say, an elementary school. So you might think, ooh, National Hurricane Center. It's 60 people there. But we do work with thousands of others to help folks stay safe. And this is a picture of Rick Nabb giving a briefing on Hurricane Sandy, which was about to impact New York, New Jersey, and, of course, New England as well. So I'm going to go through about a little bit who we are and why we do it and some of our products and try to understand what is the information we're providing to the general public, to the media, and the emergency managers. So to start off with, kind of have to show the scale of what we do, of where we have to make forecasts for. And as you can see, it extends all the way from West Africa up to Canada, all the entire Gulf of Mexico, Caribbean Sea, and the Western Atlantic, as well as the Eastern North Pacific. So we have forecast responsibilities for a big chunk of the whole Western Hemisphere. Fortunately, we have the tools and technology to be able to make predictions to help people safeguard themselves and their property. So a little bit about the Hurricane Center itself. Our facility, the National Hurricane Center is part of the National Weather Service, which is the part of NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, which is also part of Department of Commerce, DOC. So bottom line is we're federal employees. So when you pay your income taxes, you're paying my salary, okay? So that's who we are. We're federal folks helping everybody out. So we're down in Miami. We're on campus at Florida International University. And what we learned when we built the building 20 years ago is we need to make sure it's resilient. So it's poured reinforced concrete. We're 4 foot above the surrounding terrain, which used to be swampy area. And we have a giant two diesel generators in the back. So when a hurricane comes, the Hurricane Center doesn't have to leave. You know, we keep getting all the satellite data, aircraft information, and getting all of our products out to the whole world. So that's important for us to stay in operations. We have three main groups at the Hurricane Center. We have 10 hurricane forecasters. We have 18 marine forecasters in our tropical analysis forecast branch for our giant areas of the ocean that we're making predictions for. And we have 12 folks in our technology and science branch. So I get to have the best job at the Hurricane Center because I get to do hurricane forecasting in the summer and fall, marine forecasting in the winter and spring, and also helping out on developing new products. So it's kind of like Spock as the science officer there. So, but instead of seeking out new life, new civilizations, we're seeking out hurricanes and better ways to forecast it. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be at the Hurricane Center. So before we get into the hurricanes overall, I do want to talk about some of the marine predictions that we're doing and why this is important. Our TAF-B, Tropical Analysis Forecast Branch, issues predictions over the open ocean for a big chunk of the Atlantic, Pacific, Caribbean Sea and Gulf of Mexico. And if who has ever been over the open ocean, say on a cruise boat or a giant fishing boat? All right, almost half. So hopefully this was not your cruise, because if it was, you had a bad time. Oh, it should work. That's working. Okay, so there's no sound on this video, but it shows an Italian cruise boat in the Southern Ocean getting into a spot where they should not have. And what happens is the boat is getting broadsided by very steep, sharp waves, up to 30 feet high. And they were not expecting it, obviously, as people are still wandering about and the bartender's still at the bar. Yeah. Unfortunately, it starts off, you know, humorous, because you just don't see this kind of thing, but you'll actually see a lady get very seriously hurt in just a minute here, as you can imagine what it was like as the boat is rocking back and forth so quickly. And so cruise ships aren't supposed to do this, but they're supposed to stay out of harm's way. So it's our job as forecasters to make sure this doesn't happen. I mean, it's up to the captain to make decisions about where they're going to go, but we need to predict where those really dangerous conditions are, because you don't want to get hurt aboard one of these giant ships. What we also do at our tropical analysis forecast branch is provide the weather maps. So anytime you see weather maps drawn for the Gulf of Mexico or Caribbean, we're providing over a big chunk of what's going on. So before you do any predictions, you have to understand what is causing the weather, whether it's heavy rain, strong winds, or giant waves. So we make forecasts, detailed forecasts for the Caribbean, Gulf of Mexico, and Western North Atlantic, and a little more coarser forecasts for the big chunk of the rest of the Atlantic and the Pacific. And we've modernized what we're doing is to provide a digital database. So someone can go in through the next 6 days and say, well, I'm heading, say, to Bermuda from Florida. You know, what kind of wave conditions might we encounter? What kind of winds are there going to be? And of course, some of the biggest issues are when there's hurricanes out there, because they produce the mountainous waves and strong winds over the open ocean. So that's kind of, I just wanted to make sure I highlight our marine responsibilities, because it's actually the biggest chunk of what we do at the Hurricane Center. But what we mainly focus on are hurricanes and tropical storms. And so a hurricane is not a winter storm. It actually uses the warm, moist air over the tropical oceans to spin up. And so if we see something that's got a spiraling circulation, it's going counterclockwise, and it's got thunderstorms, because thunderstorms fuel the hurricane, and it doesn't have a front, then we'll start issuing advisories on it. Now, if there's other winter storms, our marine branch handles it. But what we'll do is we'll give it a number, and we'll call it a depression if the winds are very weak. Once winds reach about 40 miles an hour, we'll give it a name. It could be a boy name, a girl name. Could be English, Spanish, or French. And if it keeps going to winds of about 75 miles per hour, then it's a hurricane. And we use the Saffir-Simpson Hurricane Wind Scale to characterize Category 1, minimal hurricane, to a Category 5, catastrophic. So what's important for us as meteorologists is to focus on what are the clouds doing? Because it's actually the thunderstorms that fuel the hurricane. Without thunderstorms, hurricanes would fall apart. So it's very different from winter storms and nor'easters. Nor'easters, winter storms are kind of feasting on that cold to warm temperature contrast. In hurricanes, it's all warm everywhere, all right? So it's not a temperature contrast. It's a thunderstorms. And it's in the eye wall, which is kind of a donut-shaped area around the calm eye, and in the rain bands that surround it. So you can think of a hurricane as being a heat engine. It doesn't work very well, but occasionally you can get winds up to 200 miles per hour. So when a hurricane comes ashore, and that's what everyone here is concerned about, if one does make it up to New England, there are four main impacts that a hurricane can cause. There's the wind-caused damage. It's a picture I took after Hurricane Andrew down in my hometown in 1992. Storm surge flooding, what like occurred in New Orleans and Mississippi after Katrina. Isolated tornadoes in the outer parts of the storm, and then inland freshwater flooding from rainfall. All right, well, we're here at a university. We're going to do a couple pop quizzes. So I want everyone here to vote for which you think causes the most fatalities in the United States over the last several decades. Who thinks it's the wind-caused damages kills more people in the United States? Anybody think that? Oh, wow, zero. Okay, very confident. Who thinks it's inland flooding from rainfall? All right, about a quarter or a fifth. Who thinks it's the storm surge from the ocean? That's a definite majority. And who thinks it's tornadoes in the periphery? A couple hands. Well, it turns out that hurricanes kill from the water. And just about half is due to storm surge. And storm surge is where the ocean is pushed ashore by the winds. And you can imagine the worst case is where you could get up to 20 or even 30 feet of ocean water coming ashore. So if you're living in low-lying terrain, that is just a few feet above sea level, within even a couple miles of the coast, you're susceptible to storm surge. And you can see that the rainfall-induced flooding is not inconsequential either. Rainfall-induced flash floods, mudslides kill a quarter of all the fatalities in the U.S. And even the surf zone or offshore from ships. So a total of 85% of all fatalities in the United States from tropical storms and hurricanes are due to water, not wind. That's not what kills people. So we've had renewed emphasis at the Hurricane Center and the rest of the Weather Service to provide more focus on the water hazards, in particular the storm surge. And I'm going to talk about what we've been doing about that. Now, I'm sure some of you all had seen what happened after Hurricane Sandy along the coast of both New Jersey, New York, and even parts of Rhode Island. But I do want to point out what could be even more dramatic and why it's such a hazard to health. So this is a home about four blocks from the beach in a town called Waveland, Mississippi. And it's the day before Hurricane Katrina. And as typical, the day before a hurricane strikes, it's beautiful weather. Sunny skies, because you're in the sinking branch of the circulation of the hurricane. And perhaps David and Kimberly King should have known that when they live in a town called Waveland, that they may have a problem when a hurricane comes. So the county official told them, you need to leave. You're in a mandatory evacuation. And as in the United States, a mandatory evacuation means you need to move yourself. No one's going to throw you out of your own house. So they did the right thing. They actually have their shutters. They're about to deploy them on their windows. They got out and they left. Unfortunately, some of their neighbors did not. And when they came back, this is all they had left. So that house was affected by both 110-mile-per-hour winds, but more destructively, they had 19 foot of storm surge going through their house. Now, that 200-year-old oak tree did pretty well, but our houses aren't designed like oak trees. And so they did the right thing, but some of their neighbors did not, and they drowned. And a lot of people, you know, 1,500 between Mississippi and New Orleans drowned in a couple hours. And that was from a hurricane that every single person knew was coming. Katrina was not a surprise. It's Category 5 in the Gulf of Mexico. Everyone saw it coming. Yet, 1,500 people drowned because they didn't get out of the way, or they needed help to get out, and the help never arrived. So this is what keeps myself and folks in the Hurricane Center and the rest of the Weather Service up at nights, because we know we're going to have destructive hurricanes like Katrina, like Sandy, like the 1938 New England hurricane again, and we know what's going to happen. So we want to make sure people stay safe in the next time. Problem is, the populations along the coast keep going way up. So as the graphic here shows, there's 58 million people living in the coastal counties between Texas and Florida and the Carolinas and New England. Now, most of these areas, the population is going up very quickly. It's not as much true in New England. You have a much more stable population. But the other issue, when you look at vulnerability, you have exposure, number of people, but you also have incidents. How often do you get hit by hurricanes? And of course, you don't get hit very often. In fact, if you look at the records for Providence, the last time you had a direct hit by a hurricane was Hurricane Bob. And so that was already 25 years ago. And the last time you had a major hurricane, you have to go back to all the way to the 1940s and 1950s. So it's a long time has passed since you've had a major hurricane. So a lot of folks don't know the impacts that can occur. So this is a challenge for us in the Weather Service, increasing population, and it's very rare to get hit by a direct hurricane strike at any one location. So the experience levels are very low. So what we have access to, we're very fortunate. And dealing with this dilemma of keeping people safe, we have some amazing technology. So if you look at all the observations that we have access to at the National Hurricane Center, we're very fortunate. First off, this weather map here shows in pink ships. So ships radioing their information every 6 hours or every hourly about what are the winds, the pressures, even wave heights. And also there's moored buoys that NOAA operates that are anchored to the ocean floor and giving us the same information continuously. And then there's drifting buoys that oceanographers, such as folks here at URI, launch into the oceans. And they move around with the currents in sending back information about the temperatures, the salinities, and the and other information that can help us out. Plus all the coastal stations. Every single airport has a weather station that tells us what's going on with the winds and the pressure and the temperature and the precipitation. And even over the oceans, we have areas that we can get wind information. So all these colored swaths are winds from space. We actually have a radar called a scatterometer that bounces the energy off the ocean and returns us the wind speed over the open ocean. Right now, we're using two European scatterometers because the U.S. doesn't have a very good one right now. So we don't care who provides the information as long as we can use it. And we also have satellites that are peering over the same part of the ocean and land all the time, as well as satellites that are called low Earth orbiting satellites that spin around the Earth several times a day. So an example of that would be a picture from one of our geostationary satellites. So this is the coast of Mexico. There's a tropical storm here. And it's our job to pinpoint where is the center of that storm to the nearest 1/10 degree latitude longitude. That's 6 miles. Each box is 120 miles across. So we're trying to pick the needle out of the haystack. And the reason that's important is because as a hurricane gets stronger, the strong winds are right next to the center. It's very small scale, or what we call mesoscale. So if you're just looking at this satellite picture at night, you might say, well, maybe it's in the middle of that blob. Maybe it's here. All right. Fortunately, we can use some enhancements to the satellite imagery, and we can color code where the real cold cloud tops are, the tops of the thunderstorms. So you might say, well, maybe the center of that storm is right there underneath those coldest cloud top thunderstorms. Problem is, at night, we don't have visible imagery that has the highest resolution. So it's often a guessing game, where exactly is the center of this? So sometimes we have a polar orbiting pass that has a microwave sensor and can see through clouds. So think of it as an X-ray for hurricanes. It allows us to see through the top thin clouds to see what's going on underneath. So the red indicates very heavy rain or lots of ice, and the light blue, that little swirl, shows us where the center of it is. So it's a variety of tools from satellite, whether it's scatterometers or geostationary satellites or microwave sensors that help us answer one of the three most important questions. Where's the center of the storm? We also have techniques, both objective as well as subjective, to estimate where is the center of the storm and how strong is it. That is, how fast are the peak winds? So a technique developed back in the 70s called Dvorak allows a satellite analyst to look at a satellite loop and, depending on the curvature, to estimate where is the center, but also how strong is it. And it turns out that when a tropical storm has winds, clouds that wrap about halfway around, that's usually when it first reaches about 40 miles per hour, or when we initiate a tropical storm. So this is when Katrina was named, and this is when Rita was named. And it's using this pattern recognition technique. Now, we're also fortunate that we have, and this is only true for the United States, the rest of the world does not have this, we have the Hurricane Hunters. So there's 10 aircraft from the C-130s that the Air Force operates out of Biloxi, Mississippi. And they fly into hurricanes on purpose to figure out what's going on. We also have, in NOAA, we have two Orion P-3 and one Gulfstream 4 jet. And when I used to work at the research lab, I got to fly on board the hurricane hunters every year. And I would usually wear very ugly tropical shirts there. But these hurricane hunters allow you to find out not only where is the center of the storm, but also what are the peak winds directly and what's the size of it. Because as we saw, especially with Hurricane Sandy, the larger in extent, how far the hurricane extends from the center means the surge is going to be worse. And it also means how much wind damage is going to be caused to be more dangerous. So having the hurricane hunters allows us to better analyze what's going on now and better predict, because we have a better handle of what's going on currently. The way the aircraft are flown is typically they fly into the center, then they fly back out, they'll go downwind, and they'll fly through again. So this answers three questions for us. Where's the center? Of course, if there's an eye, it's easy. It's right there. Most of the time, you don't have a nice eye like that. It's a little sloppier. But they can actually measure the peak winds in that donut that's right around the center. It's called the eye wall. And then they can measure the extent in each quadrant around the storm of how far do the hurricane force winds and how far the tropical storm force winds extend. And when they do these flights, they're not flying over the storm. They're actually flying right through the middle of it. So this is a couple of movie loops from the Orion P3 NOAA Hurricane Hunters. And most of the time when you're flying, it looks just like that. There's a lot of gray, a lot of rain, you can't see too much at all. And that's true for about 90% of the hurricane. This is a shot inside, and the folks that will be operating some of the computer systems, and that's a tube actually for launching instruments into the hurricane. But occasionally you'll have a hurricane where the eye clears out and you're in this giant stadium. And it's unlike anything else you've ever seen on Earth. And the best analogy is a giant football stadium where you have a big circle of blue sky up above where the walls of the hurricane stop. The thunderstorms are spinning so fast they have to tilt with height. And then down below you can see patches of the ocean churning between the clouds. But instead of football players beating each other up in a football stadium, giant waves are crashing into one another. So that is something that I will always treasure, is the opportunity to fly into a storm. Another way that we measure storms, and that the engineers and technicians are so creative in helping us understand and measure what's going on. It turns out when the ocean gets churned up and there's a lot of spray and foam, that it actually emits a little more microwave radiation into the air. Now, it's not enough to cook a hot dog aboard the airplane, but there's enough microwave radiation that you can measure that with a radiometer and calibrate it and figure out what the winds are at the ocean surface. Because nobody lives at 10,000 feet where the airplanes are flying, but what you want to know, what are the winds right at the ocean, because that's what's going to hit your house when a hurricane comes ashore. So amazing technology to help us measure what's going on. We also have instruments that we'll throw into a hurricane, use once, and never see again. So we have things called drop wind sondes. They're like weather balloons. They measure temperature, temperature, pressure, winds, and humidity. They weigh about 1 pound. They have a little parachute on them. We may launch 30 of them into a hurricane, and we'll never see them again. And they cost each of, they're about $700 a pop. But the cost for it is minuscule compared to the savings that can help when we're able to improve the track forecast. So here's an idea of what a flight track may be. Each one of these numbers where we drop one of these instruments, these drop sondes, out of the plane. And when these observations get into the computer models, it helps reduce the track error, sometimes by a quarter. So in this particular case, Hurricane Bill was threatening New England, and it allowed us to better specify how close would it get to the coast and who had to prepare. So by doing these missions that may cost $40,000, we may save the U.S. taxpayers $1 million. It's a pretty good cost savings. So those are some of the ways we observe hurricanes. We observe them with satellites, which are our most important tool. We could not do our job without the satellites today. The aircraft are wonderful, and it helps us do a better job of predicting. So what do we provide when we provide the forecast to the general public? I think most folks may have seen something like this, a cone graphic that displays the track and where it may go. Before we have a storm, every 6 hours from June 1st until November 30th, we issue an outlook. Where are there systems that may form into a new tropical storm? And we'll do a two-day forecast as well as a five-day prediction. And we color code it kind of yellow, orange, red to say, well, what is a low likelihood, medium, or high chance of formation? And over the last 2 years, we've been providing an area of where it may form. So we're not providing any specific numbers yet about how strong the winds would be, how much rain, storm surge. But this is a heads up that we may have a new storm to start issuing advisories for. Once we do have a system form, the most important question is, where is it going to go? Is it going to come here? Is it going to turn out at sea? And track prediction for hurricanes is actually fairly simple. Hurricanes are pretty small scale compared to the giant weather systems all around the Earth. And the biggest player is what's called the Bermuda High. So it's an area of high pressure in the middle part of the atmosphere. It spins clockwise. So that's the reason why systems coming off the coast of Africa move toward the Caribbean. They move from east to west. But the Bermuda High tends to stop by the time it gets to the U.S. coastline, and often you'll have a trough, that orange dash line, that's moving from west to east as part of the jet stream. So if the high is a little stronger, it may push the hurricane to make landfall. If the trough is stronger, it may allow or may cause the hurricane to turn. So it's always a tough question. Is the ridge, the high pressure ridge, going to push the hurricane farther west, or is the trough going to let it turn? So when we look at the ability to make forecasts, we have these wonderful tools called computer models. And so they are projections of what might happen over the next 5 days. And there's six really good ones that we use. We use a Navy model. We use a model from the Geophysical Fluid Dynamics Lab that Professor Isaac Guinness has contributed to it over the years. We have a next generation hurricane model that we use that Professor Guinness has also been helping with. And we have a couple global models. We have a US global weather model, and there's a British one and a European one. We don't care who makes the model, as long as we get access to the forecast. And so this is Hurricane Ike, and the white line is where Ike actually went. Now, if we knew the white line in advance, we'd be billionaires, okay? We never know the white line in advance, where it actually went. But we have are these, you know, five or six different realizations of what could occur. And so we usually take a blend of these. We actually have one model. It says add them up and divide by six. So a simple consensus or simple average. And it turns out that's pretty powerful because each computer model is configured differently. They have different physics. They have different ways to bring in the observations, or what we call data assimilation. And so they all give you different answers, which is a good thing because you'll never have a perfect forecasting tool. So having different realizations or an ensemble gives you a better idea what could occur. So a couple more things about this. To me, this is a really fascinating chart because of all the things it allows us to tell about the hurricane. Now, sometimes you may see that all the models are in a good agreement. They're very much saying the same thing. So for example, when the hurricane is here, all the models are saying Ike's going to be in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico. Sure thing. And then there are times when there's a large divergence of the computer models. So for example, there. A couple models were saying Mexico, and one model was saying Ohio. Except for them ending in O, those forecasts were very different. All right? So those are ideas of when there's more uncertainty, when you have more spread in our main computer models. Now, one last thing is that these computer models can jump around. We have a new set of models every 6 hours. And, you know, the models might say, okay, it's going to hit Havana, Cuba. No, it's going to hit Miami. No, it's going to hit Kingston. Now, we can't do that with our official product. If we started windshield wipering left and right, back and forth, you guys would say, you're idiots. You don't know where it's going. And likewise, we can't say, okay, it's going to make landfall on Monday. No, it's going to be Wednesday. No, I'm sorry, it's Sunday, okay? We can't do that tromboning back and forth on timing either. So we can't windshield wiper in which direction, and we can't trombone too fast, too slow. So when we make changes to our track prediction from the Hurricane Center, often we're making small changes. We don't want to make a gigantic jump unless we're certain of it, because we don't want to have to go back the other way. So the good news, and to me, this is one of the most astounding things in all of meteorology, is how much better we are today than we were just a generation ago. So if we look at a two-day forecast, 48-hour forecast, back in the 1970s, it had an average error of 250 miles. So 250 miles, I'm not as familiar with the New England geography, but if we're saying Providence, 250-mile error, that could be all the way down in, what, Virginia or up to Maine. A long range. Now, the forecast the last decade, a 48-hour forecast has an average error of only about 80 miles. So our errors have been cut by more than half. That's great news because it means less false alarms. We don't want to tell you a hurricane's coming if we can take you out of that area that is under the warning. So if we can remove you from that area, then that's less people that have to prepare. So the improvements were so steady and so quick in the 1990s that we decided, well, maybe we should do a 4 and 5 day forecast. So starting in 2003, we issued a 4 and 5 day prediction, and even those forecasts have gotten better. Now you might say, well, let's see, that's now, 2020 will be here, 2030 it'll be perfect. Zero forecast errors. Well, the problem is we're never going to get there. At some point, probably the next decade or so, we're going to reach what's called the limit of predictability, where we ain't going to get any better, no matter what the technology improvements. So I think we're getting close to that in the next decade or so. And it's just a limitation of the physics that's out there. So, pop quiz number two. What does the cone mean? Everybody's seen a cone or a version of the cone. But what does it mean? So you have three choices. Vote after you see all three choices. All right, first one. The cone is the likely area of strong winds associated with the storm. Answer number two, likely location of the center of the storm. Or option number three, likely area of strong winds, heavy rain, and storm surge. All three put into one. All right, you have to vote. Who thinks it's number one, area of strong winds? A couple of folks voting, that's it. Who thinks it's number two, likely location of the center of the storm? It's about half. And who thinks it's number three, likely area of strong winds, heavy rain, and storm surge? All right, you're wrong. It's number two. And... You're not allowed to cheat looking at your neighbor there. Unfortunately, I'm afraid this is the case US-wide, that there's a lot of misunderstanding about what the cone means. The cone doesn't say anything about how much rain, how strong the winds, or how much storm surge. It just says, where is the center likely to stay? So we're always having debates at the Hurricane Center, should we ditch the cone, should we replace it? Because it gets misinterpreted all the time. What we've done in the meantime is develop new products, new tools to deal specifically with the wind and the storm surge and rain. So the way the cone is put together, to me it's pretty slick the way it's done, is that we do the 5-day forecast. And around each of the forecast points, we draw a circle. And the circle represents the errors over the last 5 years. It's actually the 67th percentile in the distribution of errors. So what it means, the cone is that draws a tangent to all those circles, and the center of the storm stays inside the cone about two-thirds of the time. Doesn't say anything about impacts. And the problem is when the storm gets real close to the coast, right before landfall, the cone is tiny. So here's Ike right before it blasts into Houston and Galveston, and the cone is tiny because we know the center is going to go over Houston and Galveston. But what's this red stuff? Well, that's the hurricane warning. That's where we think you may get hurricane wind or storm surge conditions. And the reason why, well, Ike was big. And the dark red shows where the hurricane force winds occurred, and the orange shows the extent of tropical storm conditions. Hurricanes are not a point. Sometimes they might be as small as 50 miles across. Sometimes, like Sandy, they may be 500 miles across. So you can't focus on the exact track. You can't focus on the point. So we do have that, that graphic is something we've been providing the last few years then to help people get a sense of what are the dimensions of the storm. Where is it likely to impact along the coast? For forecasting the winds, it's a little more difficult than track. Track, as I said, is fairly straightforward. But for forecasting the intensity or peak winds, you have to look at the ocean temperatures, and not just at the surface, but how deep do the warm waters go? You also have to look at, is there any dry air that might get sucked into the hurricane? Because hurricanes don't like dry air. They also don't like wind shear, where strong winds aloft kind of tear the hurricane structure apart. And lastly, hurricanes go through natural swings or cycles, where they'll have the eye form, and then an outer eye will form around it, and that outer eye will collapse in and weaken the inner one. So all of this means that it's very, 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 very difficult to forecast how strong a hurricane is going to be. And if you look at progress, again, for errors for our official forecasts, in the 80s, 90s, and the first decade of the 21st century, we really didn't get any better. But in the last several years, our errors have dropped, and I think it's due to better observations, but also these better models that we're putting together that we're getting to use at the Hurricane Center. And as I mentioned already, Professor Arginis and his group trying to couple together the ocean model and the atmosphere model, and you have to have wave model. It's super, super, super complex. But really, we think we need to get all these physics involved before we can have accurate predictions. And so we're finally getting there now. We are getting some improvements over the last decade or so. But because we're never going to have perfect forecasts for track or peak winds, never, ever, ever, they're always going to have errors, what we're trying to emphasize is more of a probabilistic approach. That is, what are your chances? And in this case, what we do is there's a mathematical simulation called a Monte Carlo approach, where we have 1,000 simulated hurricanes each time we do an advisory. And these 1,000 simulated but plausible hurricanes all have the winds associated with them. And so what we do is we add them up at each kind of 30 mile by 30 mile grid point to see how often you may have those winds. So perhaps the president of the university here at University of Rhode Island, he or she, I'm not sure who it is, they might say, I'm going to close school when the winds reach 60 miles per hour, because that's when trees might start falling down or things flying through the air. That's reasonable. But we can't tell them at the Hurricane Center or the local forecast office, you're going to get exactly 63 or exactly 55 miles per hour. We can't. We never will. But what we could do is say, okay, when Hurricane Bill comes close, you're going to have an 80% chance of those winds on campus. The president would say, okay, close school. But what if it's 50% chance of those winds? What if it's 20% chance? It's not 20% chance of a little rain falling on you. It's a 20% chance of a lot of devastation. So that's where we have to work with the decision makers, whether it's at school systems, elected officials, emergency managers, for them to understand you have to take big actions even if it's relatively small likelihood of occurrences. Same thing is true with storm surge. Again, that's where the ocean is pushed ashore by the strong winds. If we forecast, for example, for Hurricane Ivan to make to essentially pass just west of Mobile, Alabama, well, if you use an exact model, Mobile goes underwater, but Pensacola, Florida doesn't get wet at all. And the problem is our forecasting skill is not that good. So what actually happened, and this was a 12-hour forecast, the hurricane ended up passing just east of Mobile. Mobile stayed dry, but Pensacola got dunked. And so what you want to do is use, again, a probabilistic approach. What are my chances, say, for 8 foot of water or 10 foot of water at any location? All right. So again, if it's 90%, it's easy. Everyone evacuate. But what if it's 50%? What if it's 10%? So those are tough choices. So we have developed new products. This one debuted in Hurricane Arthur in 2014, but we just, Arthur wasn't a big damaging hurricane, so it didn't get a lot of notice. But this allows for reasonable worst case, a 10% chance, of how much water could occur at the neighborhood level and in what depth. So this is for use by emergency managers to help figure out evacuation zones. And at the same time, we're debuting this year a prototype storm surge warning, where we think, collaborative effort between the forecast offices and the Hurricane Center, where life-threatening storm surge could occur. And that's at least 3 foot. If you have 3 foot of water in your house, that's life-threatening. And so that's what we're going to debut. And again, it would be information that you can go drill down to the neighborhood level on where we think life-threatening storm surge could occur. Now, as I mentioned, we collaborate with lots of other agencies, both within NOAA and elsewhere. The Weather Prediction Center, Ocean Prediction Center are both in College Park, Maryland. Storm Prediction Center in Norman, they provide the tornadoes. So we interact with them to make sure that we're providing the best information possible about the different hazards, whether it's tornadoes or inland flooding. For storm surge, that's something we mainly handle internally at this point. Also, we have the responsibility through the World Meteorological Organization to provide forecasts for every country in the Western Hemisphere. So we provide the big picture look for hurricanes when they're coming across. And so we have a good relationship with forecasters in each country. In fact, this example for Hurricane Dean, when it came across the Caribbean in 2007, each one of those colors shows a tropical storm or hurricane watch or warning. And so literally what we would do, for example, when Dean was here in the Eastern Caribbean and starting to threaten Jamaica, we would make the forecast, get it all set, and then pick up the phone, call the forecaster in Kingston, Jamaica, and say, "Hey, man, there's a hurricane coming, man. You want to watch a warning, man?" And if they didn't hang up on us because of our bad Jamaican accent, they would let us know what they want for their country, because each weather service has autonomy for making decisions about what they want for their country. So we make sure to put that in our advisory information. Making the forecast is not good enough, though, because we need to make sure it gets communicated out. And so all these efforts that I mentioned about the public, emergency managers, the media, all of our products are the same for everybody. We don't have one for the president and then one for everybody else. You know, it's the same thing for everybody. So we want to make sure there's consistency between what we're saying and the local offices. And we take the opportunity to work with FEMA to make sure we get the word out. So we'll do video teleconferences to make sure that everyone's on the same page when there's a hurricane that's threatening. So one opportunity I had was when Hurricane Sandy was threatening New York, New Jersey, and New England. I got to sit in on one of these FEMA briefings called a hurricane liaison team. So I wasn't participating, I was just a mouse in the back of the room. And it was supposed to be at 1 o'clock, and it was our director, Rick Nabb, was gonna give this big high-level briefing. And I'm looking at the giant clocks in the room, and it says 1 o'clock, it says 1:02. I'm like, what's going on? Why hasn't it started? So Matthew Green, our FEMA meteorologist, said, there's only one reason why it hasn't started yet. And then the next minute, President Obama shows up on the other side. And so we're doing a live video teleconference, and our director, Rick Nabb, is very skilled at communicating the forecast and the uncertainties. He laid out the what could occur and what the impacts could be. And President Obama was asking great questions about, well, when can the first responders get in there after the storm? And tell me about the snow that might happen with Hurricane Sandy. And you know that it was a success, even though there were a few dozen people that died, but thousands and thousands were saved because evacuations were completed. You know it was a success because right after Sandy was right before the presidential election, and you had a Republican governor, Chris Christie, publicly thanking the Democrat president running for a re-election. We never, ever, ever see that where Republicans and Democrats are getting along, but because of the response of the Weather Service and FEMA and the Coast Guard, it was a success, and we kept people safe. So you might think, hurricane forecaster job, that's great. I forecast for 6 months, and then I play golf for 6 months. Dang, I want to be a forecaster. Turns out that we keep super busy in the off season because we want to make sure that the emergency managers, the TV broadcasters, the public overall understands what we can tell them and what we can't. All right, and as I showed, we're trying to provide new products to the general public for them to use. And so a lot of these require interpretation, especially small chances for a catastrophic event. So we keep real busy in the off season working with our colleagues in the Caribbean, our colleagues in the Weather Service, and the emergency managers through FEMA. I'm not going to go through this, but to me it's been amazing with my 11 years at the Hurricane Center, the improvements that we've made throughout the West Weather Service in providing new products and services to the public. And we're on track for doing more. As I mentioned, we're going to have these storm surge warnings that'll be prototyped this hurricane season. So I don't want to root for a hurricane to hit, especially for my house or your house. But if we have one hitting the U.S., we'll be able to debut this. We've actually been doing 7-day forecasts in-house for a few years, so we might go publicly with those in a while. We're also going to do pre-genesis forecasts, that is, before a storm forms, where is it likely to track? Also, because of ships going into hurricanes and everyone drowning, we're going to be putting together new products for to help the mariners over the open ocean. How big are the waves with this hurricane, and how far do they extend? So we've got some things in the hopper for the next few years. So just to wrap up, we have a hurricane problem in the United States. And if you look at the population for New England, it's similar, that the population's been going up and up and up. Other places, admittedly, faster rate of population growth. But still, you compare population to the last census, 2010, versus the 1850s. There's six times as many people. Now, hurricanes hitting New England are a rare event. You look at the number of hurricane strikes by each of those little symbols and how many were major hurricanes, that's not a lot. Again, the last official hurricane to make landfall was Bob in 1992, 25 years ago. Of course, Sandy was very close. Sandy had impacts similar to a hurricane. So when we're in these busy periods when we have multiple hurricane strikes, especially strong ones, combined with a whole bunch of people living in harm's way, there's a potential for a lot of people to get hurt and, of course, a lot of damage to be done. So it's, again, our mission at the Hurricane Center and the Weather Service to keep people safe. And there's a lot of people out there that are really naive, dare say clueless about hurricanes, and they need a lot of help. So especially this family. I mean, that guy. Look at that shirt, man. Okay, don't tell my wife I showed this picture. But it's so cool because it illustrates the families at risk, the people at risk, whether it's the newborns or the young-ish couple or the grandparents that all need to be prepared for when a hurricane comes, whether you're in Miami or Rhode Island. Thank you very much. Yeah, the question is whether the new technique that we're providing, it's called an inundation graph, will provide how far inland and how deep the water could be. And the answer is yes. Thing is, it's not an exact forecast. So what we'll provide is a reasonable worst case, that is a 10% chance of at least, say, 9 feet of water at your neighborhood. So because we know we can never exactly predict it. Can't even hope to. But if we can tell you what a reasonable worst case is, and that is what most people should prepare for, then that would be something to take action on. If I was told I had a reasonable worst case chance of 9 feet of water in my house, my family's out. We're going to go to safety. And if the hurricane doesn't make it wet at my house, I'll be very blessed and happy, but we're dry. So, yes. And more questions? Yes. Right, the two kinds of aircraft that the hurricane hunters use, the Air Force uses a C-130, and the NOAA uses an Orion P-3. So the P-3s are also used by the Navy for low-level submarine detection. Those are tanks. The wings are actually allowed to be a little flexible.
So when there's extreme turbulence, they may flap a little bit, but they don't break off.
You don't want the wings breaking off. They do have a lot of puke bags, yes. Yes. Yes.
Are you familiar with what we have in Providence and New Bedford, that we have storm barriers and pumps and stuff? Are you aware of that? And if so, are they any good?
I'm aware of them. I don't know how much protection they would provide. Dave Valley, who's here from the Northeast River Forecast Center, might be able to answer that better than I.
The Foxwood Hurricane Barry was designed to take, I believe, a storm tide of 20 or 22 feet, which would be 4 or 5 feet above what the hurricane drove up the bay. It is designed to actually do two things. It can pump out the Providence River when we have large river flows coming down the Shasta and the Muscatucket. And with the gates dropped and the stop logs put in the dike itself along the coast, it will provide complete protection for even a Category 4 hurricane for the other end. And the surge modeling that has been done does take into account that structure is there, so the water in the mapping has been dispersed accordingly. For New Bedford, due to limitations within the topography of that particular harbor, that hurricane barrier can't be overtopped in a high-end Category 3. But again, if you live behind the barrier, if you look at the flood insurance rate maps, that vulnerability is mapped out. And those people actually have a special rating. And evacuations usually do take place even with a Category 2 hurricane, just for the sake of public safety.
More questions? Yes.
More quick one. You never mentioned rogue waves in your predictions. Are they totally random? Because you do hear about ships sinking occasionally. In fact, one of our tall ships, I think, sank from a rogue wave. Is there any way to predict a rogue wave, or do they just disseminate after a short time?
I'm not an oceanographer, so I could. Isaac, you want to take that one?
Well, as far as I know, they are unpredictable. And so the physical mechanism for their formation, nothing to do with politics. Any other questions?
Yes. Yeah, one of your graphics showed a decrease in the sort of error over the last 15 years.
Yes.
Is there a single wisdom or realization that allowed this contraction or improvement of modeling in storm track that you can identify and share with us?
Sure, yeah, that would be for the track position or where the hurricanes are gonna go. Let me go back to that so we can see it. There it is. Yeah, so as you can see in the 70s and 80s, the error's gotten much, much smaller. So great improvements. So a flippant answer is we had a bunch of idiots back here and we have a bunch of geniuses. That's not the case. We had some really smart forecasters in the 70s and 80s, and it's the tools. So it's the computer models are so much more advanced, but it's also the satellite observations that get fed into the computer models. So the biggest success was in the 1990s, where the global weather model predicts weather around the whole Earth started being helpful for hurricanes. And those are the ones we really put our emphasis on, is these global models, whether it's from the U.S. Weather Service, the Europeans. We're even looking at the Japanese model this year.
But if you isolate the fact of a better real-time knowledge, uh-huh, or sensing, just the structure of models themselves, has there been any substantial identifying improvement in this sort of understanding of how the different factors of the model work have led to this kind of realization?
Yeah, well, the physics of how hurricanes move is pretty straightforward. It's kind of advection along by a stream that's meandering. So the understanding of that has been pretty good for the last several decades. But it's the computer models and their representation of the steering flow is so much better. So the satellite observations get fed into the computer models. They allow a much better specification of what's going on now. And then they integrate that forward in time, and the predictions are so much better now. So as the world weather forecastings are getting better, we've seen probably the best example of it with the hurricane track predictions.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One more question.
Last year, before the events are going on, there was a prediction there'd be X number of hurricanes possibilities, which didn't, you know, didn't pan out.
Yeah.
So that's even more, you know, errors than this. Once they get started, you have got something to work on, but you were trying to get ahead of that even.
Right.
Is that your department?
I was fortunate enough in graduate school to work with Dr. Bill Gray. He was the inventor of the seasonal hurricane predictions. And so his efforts led to a whole bunch of groups, both private sector, universities, and the government issuing seasonal outlooks. Some of them stink. Like 2013, 2014, everybody had a busted forecast because we thought those years would be busy, and it was quiet. And so the most years they work okay, but we can only say the overall activity.
Yeah.
How many storms? What we can't say is landfalls, because we don't know where they're going to form, and we don't know the steering patterns after they form. So until we can better regionalize it, I don't think the seasonal forecasts are very useful. Because even if it is busy, say you have 12 hurricanes, if they all stay offshore, well, that's not an impact for anybody. But if you have a hurricane season with only one strong hurricane and it hits a major metropolitan area, it's massive damage. And that happened in 1992 with Hurricane Andrew. It was a real quiet season, unless you lived in Miami.
All right, let's thank Dr.